Hello everyone, this is Ted Bauman here with your weekly Bauman Daily video. This week I want to talk about two things. One is unemployment, and more specifically, why the official unemployment rate does not reflect reality. And number two, what we can expect from earnings going into next year, and particularly whether that supports the thesis for a rotation into other types of stocks. One quotation that I saw earlier today said that every single presidential election for the last 40 years has been followed by a rotation of stocks out of one sector into another, not necessarily from something like technology into industrials, but usually in terms of factors like growth versus momentum versus value. So fundamentally, the question before us is what's likely to happen next year and how should we be positioning ourselves for it, something we've been talking a lot about lately here at the Bauman Daily. Let me start with a chart that shows why the stock market is so pessimistic at the moment. It's this plus the predicted failure of the stimulus talks. This chart shows coronavirus cases in the EU and the US, and as you can see, they are back on an upswing. People are starting to talk about hoarding toilet paper and things like that again, so there is pessimism in the air as well as a little bit of chill. So this is what we've anticipated to happen during the fall. And if this gets any worse, then we could expect to see potentially some more downward pressure on stock prices, certainly not the stay-at-home stocks, but some of the, you know, the more active get-out-and-do-things stocks could start to see pressure, as we have been predicting. Now, second thing I want to talk about is unemployment. Now, unemployment is important for the perspective of the stock market because ultimately, 75% of the GDP in the United States is represented by the demand from consumers. We are primarily a spending country. In order to spend, however, we have to earn. And that's a big chunk, not only of the US GDP, but of world GDP, because the United States is such a huge driver of world growth. So if we find that United States consumers are struggling, that they're not able to spend, then we can expect weakness not only in the economy, but in the stock market going forward, or at least that weakness will eventually be reflected simply because people can't afford to buy the things that even high-flying growth companies provide. So here's the story behind unemployment, and I found it absolutely fascinating. The current definition of unemployment is that to be officially counted as unemployed, you have to be earning no money at all, zip, nada, nilch, and you have to be actively looking for work. If you're not in that category, if you're earning a little bit of money, or if you are not looking for work, you're not considered unemployed. You just don't exist as far as the labor market is concerned. Of course, that is not the way things work in real life. Now, the interesting thing is that that definition of unemployment was set in the 1880s in order to make the current economic situation back then look a little rosier than it actually was. Back in those days, big business had a huge influence on government. Sound familiar? They called it the first Gilded Age. It was just beginning then. And effectively, big employers, which at that time were industry and railroads and steel and things like that, put pressure on the government to try to make unemployment look less bad than it actually was, for political reasons, basically. And we still have that system today. Now, the problem with this definition is that artificially pushes down the unemployment rate by excluding people who might be earning a little bit. You know, for example, if you drive Uber 2 days a week and you bring home $100 a week, which is just enough to pay for enough food not to die, as well as a little bit of petrol for your car, you're considered to be employed. Just as much as, say, somebody who makes $1 million a year is considered to be employed. There's no distinction. Anybody who is discouraged by the fact that they've tried looking for jobs for 6 months and can't find one and stops looking, they're not considered unemployed. They just don't exist. And finally, anybody who is looking after kids or elderly, anybody who has to stay home to care for them is also considered not part of the labor force and therefore is not counted in unemployment. On the other hand, if you count everybody in the United States who currently falls into that definition, but is looking for a full-time job that pays a living wage, in other words, a job that could actually allow them to survive without any other assistance, but cannot find one, the actual unemployment rate in the United States is 26.1%. Now, the headline rate, I'm going to show you a chart in a moment, is about 7%, 8%, but in reality, if you take it as people looking for a job that will actually pay enough for them to survive without further assistance, then the unemployment rate is 26%. Now, that makes sense to me because to be gainfully employed, in other words, gainfully employed means that you are doing something that's worth it for the person that employs you and you're doing something that's worth it for yourself, means that you need to have a job that allows you and potentially your household to survive without any other form of assistance. So you might say that 26.1% is the current gainful unemployment rate in the United States. That's the percentage of the population that cannot find jobs that will actually support them without their need for welfare or SNAP payments, food assistance, whatever the case may be. Now, if you just take the entire population, including people who are not currently looking for work and people who, would like to work but cannot, take anybody over 16 years old who isn't earning a living wage, whether they have or not, the gainful unemployment rate in the United States is, wait for it, 54.6%. So let's look at the true rate of unemployment according to these definitions. And I got these definitions from a place called the Ludwig Institute, not the Ludwig von Mises Institute, big difference there. It was founded by a guy who used to be head of statistics at the Bureau of Economic Analysis here in the United States. And his argument was that we needed to pay attention to the true rate of unemployment. The headline rate, the one that measures only people who fall into the categories of not earning a cent and wanting to work and looking for work, that shows the white line at the bottom. The other one at the top shows the true unemployment rate. And as you can see, we are at a historical norm, really. We're at about 25%, and the unemployment rate over the long term, going back to the early 90s, has kind of settled around that level. So it's not all that different, but it is extraordinarily high. The next chart shows the true rate of unemployment out of the entire population. Now, again, it's a little bit higher than it is normally, but it's still been consistently high for a long time relative to the actual recorded employment rate. Now, why does this matter? Well, it matters because I think, as I said, 75% of the U.S. population or U.S. GDP is driven by expenditures, whether for goods or services, by U.S. consumers. Now, if half of those people, over half of those people, are not earning a living wage, then by definition, they are not contributing to that 75% of GDP because they cannot. The only things they can do are buy, well, they're contributing, but they're contributing minimally. They can only buy food, basic shelter, etc., the things that nobody can live without. Now, a lot of the companies that have done well this year are companies that are predicated on the purchase of things like consumer discretionary goods. Amazon, for example, is right now about 23% of the largest exchange-traded fund that targets the consumer discretionary sector. If you're earning less than a living wage, if you're not able to make enough money to be able to survive, then obviously you're not going to be buying stuff on Amazon. Or at least if you do, it's going to be things that are, you know, survival goods. So fundamentally, these are the considerations that I've been talking about for a year now, saying that what matters in the United States economy is not just what the top line figures show you, but whether or not people can afford actually to spend and to drive our GDP higher. And I've made the case that for a lot of structural reasons, if you go back to my previous videos, all kinds of things really point towards us becoming more like a third world economy in the sense that so many people cannot contribute to the growth and the livelihood of the economy. And ultimately, that affects the stock market. Now, let's turn to the stock market. Let's look at some charts that show projections for sales and earnings growth. First chart, and this all comes from the data source that Clint Lee and I use for our analysis. So these are really the best figures you can get. They show projections for sales growth and earnings growth over the last year and a half going forward into the end of next year. As you can see, the rate of change of growth in, or rather decline in, both sales and earnings has been dramatic during 2020, and we expect that to continue for the next, or in the quarter that we're in right now, which is the fourth quarter. But starting next year, the prediction is that sales will grow and earnings will grow dramatically, and that is because companies will begin to recover and the cycle, the economic cycle, will begin to turn again, and we will start seeing people spending money. Now, remember, as I said earlier, we are consistently operating below our potential because so many people don't have money to spend. And nevertheless, based on our adjusted expectations that it's okay for that to be the case, we expect to see earnings to grow during particularly the second quarter of next year, gradually tapering off, but certainly much better than they were in 2019. So all in all, that looks good for the economy. The question is, which sectors are likely to see this kind of growth? Well, here's a chart that shows projections. One set of projections in blue is the projections for 2021 EPS growth in a variety of sectors that were made back at the beginning of April. So back on April Fool's Day this year, the blue line shows you what people thought in, earnings growth would be like in 2021. The red line shows what the current projections are, and look at the projections, how big they are. Remember, this is relative to the previous year. So the projections that were made in April were relative to 2019, and the expectation would be that 2021 would be about 30% higher. Right now, the projection is that industrials will be nearly 90% higher in terms of earnings per share. Consumer discretionary will be more than 70%, around 75% higher. And so fundamentally, all this means that these are sectors that are likely to outshine in terms of earnings growth in 2021. Partly because they're growing for normal reasons, you know, they're growing as they always do, but also because they'll be recovering from the pandemic. The next chart shows something similar, but it shows it in a slightly different way. It shows the 2019 earnings per share, 2020 and then 2021. And it shows that across the S&P 500, earnings per share have fallen and will have fallen by the end of the year pretty significantly, but then will rise again and outdo 2019. If things continue on the path that we're on. Spotting the sectors that are showing the biggest potential growth relative to 2020, i.e. the green versus the red lines, consumer discretionary, energy, financials, healthcare, industrials, information technology, those are really the big ones that are shining. And that means that those are the sectors where you'll want to look to see if there is a rotation into different types of investing, like value investing, looking for potential growth in undervalued companies. You're likely to see it in healthcare, in industrials, and so on, including consumer discretionary. But again, that includes mainly things like Amazon and companies that sell online. The last chart I want to show you is just the current estimates of price earnings ratios for next year. And again, you can see that consumer discretionary is likely to continue to be overpriced relative to the rest of the market. So what we want to do is to look back and see, well, where are reasonable earnings rates, which is around 20-21%. That's kind of the long-term norm we're looking at. Well, the big ones here that are likely to see some growth for next year are energy and information technology and industrials. So fundamentally, industrials, I want to flag that one, because if industrials are going to be priced at these levels, but they're going to see this massive growth in earnings per share that I flagged in the earlier chart, then that means that they are likely to become the target of a lot of investors looking to grab those future earnings at a discount rate. So fundamentally, that is, you know, the thesis going forward right now is that we, Clint Lee and I and my team here, are continuing to look at a rotation into value stocks, also into offshore, as I explained last week. But fundamentally, I think the critical thing to look at is that eventually things do revert to the mean, and eventually stock investors are going to want to buy companies that are generating earnings. That's particularly the case if interest rates do rise, in the sense that, for example, we've seen upward pressure on the 10-year treasury bill rate recently as people begin to essentially anticipate higher inflation if it's going to come. Now, on that point, I just want to make one point clear. Somebody criticized me the other day saying, well, you said that interest rates are not going to rise over time, but now you're saying they are. What I said earlier was that the Federal Reserve was not going to raise its interest rates, the parts that it controls. But it doesn't control all interest rates. The 10-year bond rate is set by the market. And if the market begins to sell 10-year bonds to put that money into something else, it's going to end up having an impact on the 10-year interest rate, which in turn affects stock prices because of the discounting that people use to estimate the current value of future earnings. So there you have it. That's our prediction, or at least my prediction. As things stand, I do continue to believe that the biggest driver of this underlying scenario here is not just COVID, but also the outcome of the election and the expectation that there will be a burst of spending within the first 2 years of the next administration, if it turns out to be a Democratic administration. That's not my preference necessarily. It is just what the market is pricing in. And I think if you want to get ahead of the market, you should be looking at the sectors that I've highlighted today. Particularly, I believe industrials are going to see a big bounce back. Ted Bauman speaking. I'll be back to you next week. Goodbye.